Hello, and welcome to the Chemistry Solution. This tutorial is on intermolecular forces. The first intermolecular force we're going to talk about is an ion-dipole interaction. These happen between a charged ion and the oppositely partially charged end of a polar molecule. So for example, when you have sodium chloride dissolved in water, you have the sodium and chlorine ions interacting with the partially positively and partially negatively charged portions of the water molecule. As you might assume, the strength of this interaction increases with increasing charge of the ions and also with the increasing magnitude of the dipole moment. Similar to ion-dipole interactions are dipole-dipole interactions. And you see dipole-dipole interactions occur between the positively charged end of one polar molecule and the negatively charged end of another polar molecule. So between two molecules of HCl, which have a partial positively charged end and a partial negatively charged end due to the difference in electronegativity between the hydrogen and chlorine atoms, you will see interactions between the positively charged end of one HCl molecule and the negatively charged end of another HCl molecule. And again, as you might assume, the strength of these dipole-dipole interactions increases with increasing polarity of the molecules. Another type of intermolecular force is hydrogen bonding interactions. Hydrogen bonding interactions are a special type of dipole-dipole interactions. And they happen between the partially positively charged hydrogen atom in a polar bond and an unbonded electron pair on oxygen, nitrogen, or fluorine. So just remember, this is a special case of dipole-dipole interactions, and it occurs between hydrogen and either oxygen, nitrogen, or fluorine. Hydrogen bonds are much stronger than dispersion forces, which I haven't mentioned yet, or dipole-dipole interactions, and that's why this type of interaction is typically called a hydrogen bond, although hydrogen bonds are not nearly as strong as a typical ionic or covalent bond, so the nomenclature may be a little bit misleading. The last intermolecular force that I'm going to talk about are London dispersion forces. London dispersion forces are due to an instantaneous dipole in a molecule. And that may sound a little bit confusing, but even if you have a nonpolar bond, the position of electrons around one atom will affect the position of electrons around another bonded atom. And so this creates an instantaneous dipole. It's not a permanent dipole like in polar molecules, but these instantaneous dipoles, just like in dipole-dipole interactions, allow the slightly positive and slightly negatively charged portions of different molecules to interact. And so you see London dispersion forces in all molecules, whether they're polar or nonpolar. The strength of these forces increases with increasing molecular weight. And going along with that, they're also affected by shape. So the larger a molecule is, and the more surface area it has, the more opportunity it has to interact with other molecules, and the greater the London dispersion forces. If you have two molecules with similar molecular weights, but one type of molecule is very compact, that molecule will have less London dispersion forces. So looking at the relative strengths of interactions, London dispersion forces are typically the weakest type of interaction of the interactions we've listed today. However, they're so prevalent in most molecules that they often account for the majority of interactions between molecules. Next is dipole-dipole interactions, then hydrogen bonds, followed by ion-dipole interactions. Now, ionic and covalent bonds are not a type of intermolecular force. By saying intermolecular force, we're talking about different molecules interacting. But I threw ionic and covalent bonds on this chart of increasing strength just so we remember that all of these intermolecular forces are not as strong as the bonds you see within a molecule. Let's look at a problem. Identify the predominant intermolecular forces in each of the following compounds. A, carbon tetrachloride. If you were to draw this molecule out, you would know that it's a nonpolar molecule. And the only intermolecular forces we'll see between these molecules are London dispersion forces. B, hydrofluoric acid. If you drew out a molecule of hydrofluoric acid, you would see that the bond is polar, and hydrofluoric acid is a polar molecule. Now remember that both polar and nonpolar molecules have London dispersion forces. But because hydrofluoric acid is a polar molecule and contains fluorine, which is one of those three atoms we say that are involved in hydrogen bonds, hydrofluoric acid will also have hydrogen bonding between the molecules. C, sulfur dioxide. Once again, all molecules have London dispersion forces, regardless of whether they're polar or not. Now, sulfur dioxide is a polar molecule, and you could determine this by drawing out the Lewis dot structure and determining the molecular geometry of this molecule. Because it's a polar molecule, but doesn't contain hydrogen bonds, you will see dipole-dipole interactions between molecules of sulfur dioxide. Let's try another problem. Knowing that stronger intermolecular interactions lead to higher boiling points, predict which compound from each of the following pairs will have the highest boiling point. Looking at A, we have NH3 or CH4. We know that both of the molecules have London dispersion forces, but these molecules are approximately the same molecular weight, so the London dispersion forces should be about equal. But we know that in molecules of NH3, we'll have hydrogen bonding interactions, and there are no other interactions besides London dispersion forces in CH4. So we can predict that NH3 will have stronger interactions and have the higher boiling point. B, H2S or H2O. Both of these molecules are polar, so you will see dipole-dipole interactions between molecules of each of these compounds. But H2S just has your typical dipole-dipole interactions, where H2O has hydrogen bonding interactions. So between these two pairs, H2O will have the higher boiling point. C, ethanol, which is listed first, or propanol, which is listed second. Because each of these alcohols contains an OH group, each of these molecules will be slightly polar and have hydrogen bonding interactions. However, the main attractive force between either ethanol or propanol will be London dispersion forces. But because propanol molecules are larger than ethanol molecules, the propanol molecules will experience greater London dispersion forces, and thus propanol has the higher boiling point. In D, we're given two molecules, pentane and neopentane. Now, you don't need to know the names of these molecules, but what you would notice is that they are both comprised of the same number of carbon atoms and the same number of hydrogen atoms. But pentane is a straight chain molecule, where neopentane is a branched, more condensed molecule. Because these two molecules have similar molecular weights, the London dispersion forces won't differ on size alone, but you will see greater London dispersion forces in pentane, or the straight chain molecule, because these straight chain molecules have a better chance to interact with other molecules of pentane. So in this example, the first molecule, pentane, will have the higher boiling point. Thanks for watching The Chemistry Solution. We hope you enjoyed this tutorial.